This podcast is brought to you by LMU Munich.
Okay. So I will still continue before turning to QCD, which is what we are more interesting in, because it is ubiquitous at Hadron Collider. I would like still to perform another short calculation in QAD, also because the technical details that we saw in these E plus E minus, mu plus mu minus, and what we will see now in terms of electron positron to gamma gamma scattering will be exactly the same kind of situation that one would meet in the QCD calculation involving, of course, quarks and gluon. And so I will be faster on that side once we'll have understood it. The situation in the QAD level. So let's address, for instance, the calculation of E minus E plus to gamma gamma which in QAD involve two kind of Feynman diagrams. Here we have the E minus, E plus, and then we have here the two gamma, particle 1 is plus, particle 2 elicited minus, and then we have 3 and 4, and then we have an equivalent diagram where the photons are exchanged. So this time the elicited of the particle is fixed, D plus. And then we have photon 3 and photon 4. Okay. The two diagrams can be combined in one amplitude. So in this case, IM is the sum of two terms. So we have IE square. And then we start directly in spinor notation. We can follow the arrow, the first diagram, the fermion line, so we have a 2. Then we can put a big parenthesis, a polarization vector plus, a polarization vector 4, epsilon 4. Then we have a fermion propagator, in momentum k2 plus k4. And then we have S24. Then there is a polarization vector 3. And then we have propagator. Sorry. And then we have, so this would be the first, the contribution to the first diagram. And the second, in the second, epsilon 3 and epsilon 4 are exchanged. T slash I 2 plus 3 S 2 3 epsilon 4 slash, and both diagram, the fermionic current is closed by 1. Okay, so this is the generic structure for this explicit choice of fermions, and for the moment I have not chosen yet the explicit polarization of the photon. The cases that that we have are again 4, so the photon can be both plus or both minus, or they can be plus minus and minus plus. And again, the plus plus case and the minus minus case are related by parity, as well as the plus minus and the minus plus. So we will only be interested in describing two of this situation, because the other can be obtained simply by parity. So let's see what happens in the case of gamma plus, where both photons are plus. If we choose for both polarization vector, the reference momentum Q1 equal to Q2, equal to to the momentum of the fermion 2, we can represent epsilon plus on momentum 3 like 2 gamma mu 3 over square root of 2, 3. And epsilon plus 4 mu is 1 over square root of 2 gamma mu 4 over 2, 4. So in general, I have the freedom to choose for each photon an independent, to have for each photon, for each polarization, an independent reference momentum. But for simplicity, in this case, being both having the same polarization, I choose also the same reference momentum, which, by the way, is exactly the momentum of one of the two other particles involved in the scattering. Let's see what happens here when I choose epsilon 4, for instance. When I choose epsilon 4 with this definition, okay, I have to evaluate in the first diagram something. So the amplitude I am is proportional to something which is 2 epsilon slash plus 4. Okay, and then there is all the rest. It's enough to stop here, because when I dot the epsilon slash definition that I gave you in the previous lectures, I get something which is proportional to 2, 2, and then I have 2, 4, dot, dot. So this amplitude, this choice of reference momentum, makes the first diagram vanish. Okay? And the second happen, the same thing happens also with this choice of epsilon 3, when epsilon 3 acts on 2. Okay? So the entire amplitude is 0 plus 0, and it vanishes. So scattering amplitudes involving one fermion line and two light-like like helicity vector boson, massless vector boson, vanishes. And the fact that vanish in the plus case will also imply a vanishing in the case of gamma minus, gamma minus. Okay? I will not... I think, is that clear to everybody what is the mechanism that makes this amplitude to vanish? Okay, it's a Dirac equation, massless Dirac equation, implemented to a very special choice of a reference vector, which I'm entitled to do, so I can do that choice. Of course, with another reference vector, the result would have still been zero, but it would have been much more difficult to see. Okay, now, just in one line, okay, very small calculation, we realize that. So the non-vanishing, the non-vanishing case instead, it's when we take into account the possibility of having opposite helicity gammas. Okay, in this case, epsilon plus 3 still stays the same. Gamma mu 3. Square root of 2, 2, 3, and epsilon minus 4, this time is chosen with another choice of polarization state, being it 1, or reference momentum, being it 1. Okay. So here I have Q. Okay, there was a mistake. So this was Q3, Q4, because it was the reference momentum of particle 3 and particle 4. So Q3 stays 2, and Q4, the reference momentum, is 1. Okay, so since for epsilon 3 nothing changed, with this choice, I can already eliminate one contribution from my calculation. So for the same reason as before, this choice of epsilon 3 makes the second term here to vanish. Okay, so actually the amplitude for this elicity configuration, it's only given by the first Feynman diagram. And so before computing it, let me recall this alternative definition, that so this slash definition, that epsilon 3 plus was defined like square root of 2 to 3, and then we have 3 2 plus 2 3, and equivalently epsilon minus 4 slash we use 1 4 4 1 plus 1 4. Okay, now we have all formulas to carry out the calculation. Okay, this is the diagram that we want to compute, and this is the first piece that we need. So the amplitude I am in this case will be minus I square S to 4, and then I have a factor 2 minus 2 coming from the product of square root, and I have 2 3 1 4 2 4, then I have 1 2 plus 4, I have 2, and then I have finally 3, 1. Okay. This factor is still the same, minus I E2. I can write it S24 is equivalent to S13 because it's a 2 to 2 scattering. So plus, there is a 2, and then here I can open 2, 4, then I have 1, 4. The 2 does not contribute here because when it acts on the two spinors, angle spinors, due to the Dirac equation, it vanishes, so only the 4, and so I can have 1, 4, 4, 2, and then close 3, 1. And the denominator here still involves 2, 3, 1, 4. And now I can cancel this 1, 4 with 1, 4. S, 1, 3, I can write it like 1, 3, 3, 1, so that the 3, 1 and the 3, 1 cancel. And I find, as a final result, 2i e squared 2, 4 squared 2, 3, 3, 1. Okay, so we have seen hopefully the sign are correct. So we have seen in these two kind of calculation, the one of E plus C minus, a fourth fermion-like scattering, and in this Compton-like calculation, a fermion plus vector boson, massless vector boson scattering, which are a QED prototype for a QCD more involved calculation. And the elements that emerge from this calculation is that some terms, some amplitude, entire amplitude might vanish soon by a clever choice of reference momentum. And actually these are exactly the Spinor the Dirac equation that made vanish in the like-like elicity case are the mechanism that we will use and we will see also for in practice to simplify our calculation in QCD. For the QCD part, I will mainly use some material from the lecture of Michael Peskin, except for some color algebra that I will perform at the blackboard. But also all the kinematic, we can follow it on the slides. Okay.
Excuse me.
Yes.
Priori, you don't know how to choose this Q, right?
So a priori, I can choose anything. Even if I make, let me say, a wrong choice, the result doesn't change. Just that to find it out, the vanishing, for finding out the vanishing, I should perform some more gymnastic, like say, with Spinor's algebra, but there is no... but the result is gauge invariant. The result of the Hamilton is gauge invariant, therefore doesn't depend on the explicit choice. Okay. So, QCD. As we all know, QCD theory. Okay, sorry. Sorry, can you?
Usually you have to fix the gauge, use ghosts, and so on.
Yes, yes. These rules mainly apply, let's say, in axial gauge or Feynman covariant gauge. Apart from the choice of the gauge in this sense, which on which depends the form of my propagator, whether or not I want to combine ghosts or keep them as a separate degrees of freedom. This is just, it is related to gauge invariance, the choice of reference momentum is just the freedom that one has to form a form momentum, let's say, when you have only 2 degrees of freedom fixed by the on-shellness requirement, and then you need, anyway, a reference momentum that allows you to find out the other two components. So in this sense, let's say gauge freedom is the choice onto which I can decompose the momentum of the polarization. Okay. So when we think of QCD, as we know, we need to extend. So the Feynman rules are more or less like QED, but the group. Since gluon carry color, an additional quantum number, we need to extend the gauge group to SU3. For the sakeness of generality, I will describe the scattering among SUN particles, okay? And we will put then n equal 3 whenever we need. I'll just briefly remind what we presumably all know, that quarks are column vectors that transform under the fundamental representation. Anti-quark are row complex column which transform under the anti-fundamental, and that the generator of the SUN group are n squared minus 1, where the minus 1 is due to the traceless condition, fulfilling the Lie algebra commutator relation. They have a representation in the adjoint, so that they can be expressed in the adjoint representation in terms of the constant structure constants of the group, and fulfill the Jacobi identity. This is just to recall, of course, I cannot I cannot go into the derivation of this formula, but presumably we are all familiar with it. In covariant gauge, the QCD Feynman diagram are a little bit richer, okay, than QED case. In particular, apart from the presence of the ghosts, which have been mentioned, related to conservation to the world identities, we have self-interacting fields, okay, and these self-interactions is realized through through vertices, triple vertices, and three gluon vertices and four gluon vertices, which have, apart from a kinematic structure, they also have a charge under the color group. So all the QED vertices are promoted to carry some charge for the coupling of the gluon to the fermion, and also there are charge in the adjoint representation for the self-interacting field. Let's promote our calculation, our Compton calculation, to a QCD version. So a scattering between the quark, between quark and gluons. The first two diagrams are exactly like the one that we have computed, at least under the kinematic point of view. Okay. The third diagram, it's new because of the interaction of the of self-interaction of the gluon. And although maybe I don't know how much you can see it, here these two diagrams have the same kinematic structure as the QED, but they carry color group coupling, color charge coupling. Here we have gluon 2, which carry an index TA, and here TB. Okay? This other diagram, instead, contains a commuted charge, namely TB and then TBTA. Okay? So while for QED we could simply add these two diagrams together to the same, let's say, in the same amplitude, here we can try to decompose the amplitude in terms of its color structures. Okay? So in QED we didn't care, we just plugged the two diagrams together. And here we can try to organize our calculation a little bit better. So the first two diagrams are already independent, so they carry independent color structure. How about the third diagram? Is it a new color structure, or can it be combined to the one before? So thanks to the commutation relation fulfilled by the generator of QCD, you see that these three gluon vertices, okay, can be split in a term which has the same color structure of the first diagram, and in a second term that has the color structure of the second. Therefore, we could combine, okay, first of all, we isolate in the entire amplitude only two color structure, TA-TB and TB-TA, okay? And the third diagram, the kinematic part of this diagram, contribute both to the first and to the second color order term. Okay. Here we see a clear it emerged the concept of color ordered amplitude. In this example, technically the amplitude can be decomposed in a group factor, which factorizes completely from the kinematic factor here written with this fat m, where the fat m in the order 1, 2, 3, 4 only binds the contribution of two diagrams which have fixed order of the fixed order of the external legs. Okay. So, namely, we see that color here imposes, if we exploit the color structure, we can use color to impose bounds on the kinematic structure of the amplitudes. And in this representation, where the color is factorized from the kinematic term, we call the kinematic amplitude, the kinematic tab color ordered amplitude. Okay, so this is exactly, this fulfills rules which have no color anymore, but just Feynman rules which involve kinematic, which takes the kinematic term of the trigluon vertex, for example, only. Okay, and we can get the second partial amplitude 1, 3, 2, 4 simply by the same final expression of this one and swapping, okay, the label of gluon 2 and gluon 3. Okay, this kind of decomposition, which we will see a little bit more, will also be important to understand probably the lectures of John Joseph Carrasco, where we will see how group theory can impose bounds on the kinematic part of amplitudes. Okay? So it is clear that a good way to compute scattering amplitude is really to exploit this factorization of colors, degrees of freedom, from the kinematic degrees of freedom. And so I would like to show you how one can handle, how one can compute color factors for Feynman diagram and for scattering amplitudes, for squared amplitudes, simply by using diagrammatic rules, rather than getting crazy after the indices of color charge and in the adjoint representation and fermion, anti-fermion indices in the fundamental. Okay, the basic building block are diagrams, okay, which looks like a Feynman diagram, which have no kinematics in it, but just the color that they represent. So this would be simply the color in the fundamental representation. This is the structure of the color in the adjoint. Then we would have a fermion line IK, and then the delta representing a delta, Kronecker delta AK, and here the delta AB in color space. There is evidently a typo, should be AB as well. The traceless, the number of color is it's represented by fermion loop, the traceless condition by this tadpole-like diagram, and also the normalization of the generator by this vacuum polarization-like diagram. So what can we do with this color? We need to find a set. At the end of this calculation, we will find a set of diagrammatic rules which will enable us to perform color group calculation. And in order to do that, let's try to find a relation for the color structure, for instance, of a quark, anti-quark scattering. So one of the main useful rule that we need to have attend is how to calculate what is the color factor of this diagram. So we label IJKL. Okay. Equivalently, this would be TAIJ TAKL. Okay. From the group theory point of view, this product of tensors in the color can only have two form factors. Let's parameterize it like delta IL delta KJ minus beta delta IJ delta KL. Okay, in terms of the diagrammatic rules, we would type it as alpha. There will be a delta function connecting I with L, another delta function connecting K with L. And then there is the beta and the two delta function KL IJ. Okay, so you see that the external, the order of the external particle it's kept, and then we work in this Feynman representation. So let's take in diagram representation. Actually, this algorithm is called the Civitanovic algorithm. And it enables us to remove the gluon color from the calculation. So the first thing that we do, let's take these two lines and close together above, which means multiply these tensors here by a delta function LK. I will do it directly in diagrammatic form. So the down part remains the same, IJ, and we close the loop. Okay. What happened here? We have IL minus beta, and here we have this, and this we have. Sorry, there is a J. Okay? Now we see that this thing on the left hand side is zero because of the traceless condition there. Okay? So this amplitude must vanish. So this color factor must vanish, okay? Because of it. And here, okay, this line is the same. These things is N C. So we find by setting to zero this object, by imposing zero on this condition, that beta must be technically 1 over this fermion loop, namely 1 over NC. Okay. Okay. So we have fixed the first constant, a known constant. And now we'll fix the second other constant, doing a similar case, doing a similar calculation, namely we will attach to the fermion loop also a gluon. We'll join the two. So technically what we are using these two operators, okay? So we start again from the equation above, and this time we not only close it by a fermion loop, but we attach a gluon. Here we have alpha, here we have the same kind of diagram with a gluon, minus 1 over nc. This time we know that beta is nc. And here we have this other diagram. So by multiplying by this operation, you see we were able to project out technically this second contribution because this is zero again. Okay. And this is alpha, a 3-point, it's a 3-point like vertex. But also the vacuum polarization diagram is TF, which is a normalization factor in the fundamental representation. So the left-hand side of the diagram becomes TF times the gluon, and therefore alpha is equal to TF. Okay? Because this guy here, when I replace the vacuum pole by TF times the gluon, gives me back again the vertex, which is here. Okay, clear? Okay, so we have found finally at this color diagram can be, so the gluon in the fermionic exchange can be expressed, can be removed and be expressed in terms of delta function, like in the fundamental representation. The choice of TF is really a normalization factor. There are authors that use it 1/2, either 1 or 2, according to the amount of square root that people use to define their color charges. And we will also fulfill the same. We will see in different calculations different definition of the TF. So this is the first rule that we have found. Another important rule is the one associated to the commutation relation TA TB equal I FABC TC. Okay. Let's write it the other way around. Let's start first with representing this color structure. And we can do it here with the 3 gluon vertex. Here we have A, B, and then there is a C. And we go anticlockwise. The fermion arrow is this way. And then we write the grammatical representation of TA, TB minus TBTA. Okay, this is the color diagram for this equation. Now let's close the fermion line from below and attach a gluon. Okay, we start with this diagram here. So we have this. Fermion line like this. Then we close okay. This is color C. And minus AB. Okay. Now we can use the fact that this vacuum polarization is equivalent to TF times the gluon. Namely, this can be rewritten. Times TF, okay. So by inverting, by reading this equation the other way around, we have a rule that allow us to remove FABC color structure from our calculation and transform them in traces 1 over TF. And so we have A, B, C this way minus A, B, C this way. Look that in swapping around the two gluon, the fermion flow changes, and this can be its equivalent to these rules I F A B C equal to 1 over TF. And here, what these things mean are simply traces of color charge. So this is the trace of TA, TB, TC minus the trace of T, TA, CB. So this is the second identity, which it is very useful to handle color group calculation. And the last, let's represent it, the Jacobi identity. Jacobi identity, we have I F B C D times I F A C D plus I F D A C I F B C E plus I F ABC times IF DC equals 0. Let's try to give a contribution, a diagrammatic form to this equation. First thing that we have to do is to have the triple Gouraud vertex for BCD. So we have BDC. Okay. We start with BDC. Then we have ACE. ACE is ACE. Okay. First term. Let's go on the second. The second is DAC. This is D, this is A, okay, and this is C, this is B, C, E. The last one is ABC, DC. Okay, we'll do it. Last one is ABC times DCE. So I have ABC this way. And DCE, okay, equal to 0. These are not cut, just. Now, in order to read the identity, let's keep the external gluon, the external color in the same position. So the first one, let's start from this. Let's say that we like this ordering A, B, D, E. And let's try to do the same for the second. In order to have A in this position, I just take this leg and put down here, okay? So the upper part of this diagram stays the same. This is D and this is B, but the A, I stretch it down here. A and E, I stretch down here, okay? And let's watch at the arrows as well. And the last diagram, this one, we will, A and B, they are okay, but we have to flip D and E. So when we flip we have to watch out. So AB, when we flip D here and E, this now has an arrow which is clockwise, and if we want to have everything anti-clockwise, we have to change the sign of this arrow, namely this diagram alone becomes minus 1, AB, D, E, and then we change the sign because FABC it's gets assigned when you read it the other way around. Okay, so this is the form of the of the Jacobian identity, and I will collect. Okay, I will collect in the slide the way it is technically used and will be used mainly by John Joseph in his lectures. This can be these Jacobian identities enable to use a color in order to find a relation between non-planar scattering amplitudes with respect to planar one. Okay, so these are the four basic color group rules that one needs in all computation of QCD. And let's see how these rules that we have derived can be applied in practice in our prototype calculation, namely a four fermion scattering, which in QED was E plus E minus mu plus mu minus, and now becomes Q Q bar to Q prime mu bar. So this is we take this rule that we have found IJ. This is here rewritten IL KJ minus 1 over NC, the arrow in this way, JI LK. Okay, this would be the color factor of a four fermion scattering. Let's see how this color enter in the matrix element square. So as we did in the E plus E minus, we will square the kinematic amplitudes, and together with squaring the kinematic we have to square also the color. And here we are interested only in the color group. Okay. This here, this here. Whew. Let's keep track of the fermion flow. Here we have I, L, K, J. Okay. So now we have to square this side. Very good. So TF becomes square, and this rule I will deform them in this way. I'll turn the I up and the J down according to the diagram on the left hand side. So I will have IL, I have KJ minus 1 over n, and here I'll try to keep the same distances. I have I L K J, and the fermion flow is this way and this way. So this is the left-hand side diagram. The right-hand side will be the complex conjugated, which I do it directly in the grammatic form, ILKJ minus 1 over NC. Here I have KL IJ. In that step, I didn't do anything. I just deformed a little bit my line in order to help me in doing the next calculation, which is the actual product of the two color structures of both sides. So this is equal TF squared. Now the first term will involve the product of this object times the first. Okay, so this is two circles. Then I have the first times the second term, which is minus 1 over NC. Here I have half a donut like. Okay. And the flow is this way. Then I have the second times the first, 1 minus NC. Here I have these things, and then I have 1 over n c squared, which is simply two circles. Okay. Then now we can replace the symbols with the quantity that they represent. Namely, each closed circle is nc, so here we have nc squared minus 1 over nc, this is nc, minus 1 over nc, and this is again nc, and then this is 1 over nc squared, and this circle is nc, so this is nc squared, and we find that the color structure of the amplitude square of two different flavor of quarks is TF squared and C squared minus 1. Sorry, this is a plus, this is a plus. Thank you very much. Thank you. I like it very much. Okay, so we have seen color rules, color diagrammatic rules at work, and how easy they can be implemented. The only attention one must pay is with the direction of the arrow line, but this is much better than getting crazy after indices for the Fermi, for the adjoint, and for the fundamental representation, I guess. In the approaching, let's say, in the last half an hour, approaching the conclusion of the lectures, I would like to recall, so move toward the N-gluon, the N-gluon scatterings in QCD, which probably will also be discussed by other people, and I will mainly follow Michael Peskin calculation, since equations were already nicely written down. So we will try to reproduce or to I'll try to clarify the steps in those calculations to really to share to understand the basic structure of four gluon scattering, which is the prototype which is a prototype structure for the n all n gluon scattering at three level. Okay, so pardon, sorry, I didn't hear you.
NC square minus 1
is the dimension of adjoint. Is the dimension
so
of the adjoint.
Is this an accident, or can you associate a Feynman diagram with the representation?
No, I think it is not an accident. You can really find there are other other rules which enable you to find all, for instance, the Casimir relation between the fundamental and the adjoint and C and the dimension of the space. They can all be found by diagrammatic rules. So it's all but, I think, accidental. Okay, so I think it's very well formed. So for the four gluon scattering, okay, to the four gluon scattering UCD, we need to add the contribution of three type of diagrams. Okay, we have the planar, the non-planar, so the S channel, the U channel, and T channel, and also a new ingredient, which is the four gluon interaction. We have already. Why I try to share with you these. Knowledge about the group factor, because the message that I would like to give you is that a factorization of the color group from the kinematics is extremely can be very helpful in calculation, and so we would like to work only with color ordered amplitude, and in fact also the four gluon amplitude can be decomposed in color ordered partial amplitude here, in terms of six partial amplitudes, according to the six possibilities, that, six non-cyclic permutations that one can have with these color matrices. Okay, in order to understand or to derive this decomposition, so of the entire amplitude in terms of six main building block, one needs to understand how to get down to the decomposition of the color structure, because once you know the color, how the color decomposes, automatically the kinematics follows bound to the color. In order to do that, one need to use these diagram, these rules, which we have derived diagrammatically a few minutes ago, and the new ingredient that we have here, and that I will try to prove again diagrammatically, is not only a relation between a single structure constant with respect to the trace of generators, but also what is the decomposition of the product of two structure constants. Here we see already the result. It can be written in terms of four or four traces. This is the main building block for the color decomposition of all amplitudes, because each of these three gluon vertices carry an FABC constant, and also the new element, the new ingredient, the four gluon, indeed can be written as a linear as a combination of three terms, each of which carries a FABC, the product of two structure constants. So if we can understand how this equation can be derived, the rest will follow automatically with a bit of patience. And in order to do that, let's go back to our Feynman, to our color diagrammatic rules. This object A B CD is proportional, so contains F A B E F E C D. We can use the formula that we have derived before. I will pose TF equal 1. So we can replace each F by the color trace, by the trace of the color element. So we have A, A, B, A, B, E, minus trace A, B, E in the other direction. This is the first F, and then the other one will be this. Is CD. CD minus D is C. In the other, EDC. Okay. Here we have the product of four objects. This is the arrow. Then this way, this way, and here we have this way and this way. Okay, so I multiply the four objects, the four terms all together, and now we can remove the gluon. Propagator in between with the other identity. With this, I'm making use. So we have used this for the FABC, and now we remove the gluon with this one. We have to be a little bit careful. So now we have a color flow from one diagram to another. So we will have a fatty circle between the two, where we have A, B, C, B. Minus 1 over nc, and now these two factorize. B, A, C, D. So this is the first diagram. Now we have the second diagram. Look at the arrow, how they change direction among the two. So here we'll try to do like this, and then we have CBAD AD minus 1 over NC, and again the two factorized guy like this, and this is like this. B A D C. Then we have the third diagram, which is similar in shape here, but the fermion flow goes in the other direction. So we have again kind of and the Feynman flow goes in the other direction. C minus 1 over nc. And here I have this direction, ad. You see? And the last final contribution, it's like the first, but in the other direction. AD. Okay, luckily we made it. Okay. So the first thing that we observe here is that these factorized contributions are all proportional, each of them is proportional to the delta function of the color at the AK array. Oh, remember, this was the last equation on this side. Okay. So each of them, this is delta AB, this is delta CD, the same here, delta AB, delta CD, so they drop out of the calculation, so because they have opposite side, a minus, plus, plus, minus, okay? So these things drops out from the calculation. Remember, please, for the next 10 minutes, the fact that this part of the calculation proportional, let's say, to this 1 over nc term coming from the color algebra drops out. And what we are left with is the final result we were after, because so the first is already okay, and it is ABCD, the fermion flow goes in this way. The second, let's make it as a planar diagram, so this becomes like this, and it is ACB. Like this, then we have a planar version. The fermion goes this way. Now let's write down the trace reading against the color flow. So this is the trace of ABCD. The trace of ABCD minus the trace of ACDB. ACDB minus the trace of, here is ABDC. ABDC, right? Then this trace of ACDB. ACDB. And here we have the trace of BADC. DC. Which close our calculation, which are exactly the four traces that appear in the decomposition that we need in order to decompose in the main building color blocks our four fermion amplitudes, four gluon. for gluon amplitude. Okay. So thanks to this decomposition, also the four fermion, also the four gluon vertex can be decomposed technically in a very in a color ordered way, so that the kinematic part involving the metric tensor simplifies, and then there are five more contribution of the same type. And in this way, okay, having stripped completely the color from the kinematic, we could use QCD Feynman rules in a color order way where the self-interaction vertices for the triple gluon and the four gluon are more compact than the full vertex of combining SUN color plus SUN color plus kinematic. Okay. Now, the two ingredients of a color decomposition of scattering amplitude are the color group factor and also the kinematic factor. The kinematic factor, okay, in this case, for instance, for the first amplitude M1234, involves only color ordered Feynman diagram. Okay, so we have the S channel, the T channel, and the four fermion and the four gluon amplitude, and this can be written down with the techniques that we have been describing before. Okay, this decomposition for the color order amplitude involving the color order Feynman rules is valid for all elicities. For the moment, I didn't specify the elicity of the gluon. In order to carry out in order to find the explicit form of each elicity amplitude for all the elicity that we can assign, we now need to assign plus and minus in all possible case, use our spinorial notation, and perform the algebra. And this should be clear by now, having worked out the rules before for fermion scattering and the Compton, and they are available both in Peskin lectures and Lance Dixon lectures, so you could follow. You have now the means to follow them. I will just sketch on the result. In particular, one finds that for all positive elicities, okay, due to the same mechanism for which in the Compton scattering, the two photon whenever like elicity vanishes, you can verify that both for all positive elicity and for one negative elicity, everything positive, the amplitudes in both cases completely vanishes. Okay, so the first case when we get a non-vanishing amplitude is when two gluon have a certain elicity and the other two have opposite elicity. And these are called maximally elicity violating. So don't get confused by names and what they represent. We all know you should be able to compute what they represent. And so even if they have this sexy name, okay, let's not get scared when we list them in the subsequent lectures of maximal elicity violation. You know how to compute them, and that is extremely important. What you do exactly, you use an explicit definition of polarization vector. And what happens, for instance, in the minus minus plus plus, you get an expression which is simple enough, of the same like we have found before. Then the other non-vanishing elicity is minus plus minus plus. Okay, look at the structure of these two equations. They only involve angle products, and on top of the numerator, there are always the fermion related to the negative elicity gluon. Okay. This structure one kind of spinor product, and the presence of negative of spinors related to negative electricity gluon in the numerator of the maximum electricity violating amplitude, it's extendable to an all-n result, and that was discovered by Park and Taylor in 86 and proved by Behrens-Gille, namely that no matter how many gluons you have in your scattering, if two of them have opposite electricity to the rest, the previous formula gets a trivial extension. And these are called, will be called MHV amplitudes. By parity, you now know that we can flip the angle with the square and get the electricity amplitude for gluon when two gluon have plus electricity and all the rest negative electricity. So these are two electricity amplitudes only. Of course, so if we want to do a whole n scattering, we need to know the all other scattering amplitudes with related with more minus, more plus, and vice versa. But these two are very special, and we will they have boosted, I would say, this new development. So the mathematical framework have boosted development, new mathematical framework in these last 5 or 6 years. Okay. So before closing, the lecture, and this was the first jump to an all-n three-level result, let me give you the extension of the color decomposition for an endpoint gluon amplitude and gluon scattering amplitude. What we have seen in the four gluon scattering, okay, with a factorization of color and kinematics involving only the non-cyclic permutation of traces.
I do not understand the definition of MHV for in gluon amplitudes, how many negative helices?
Two. Always two. Two and infinite minus two. So two helicity, the particle I and particle J
only.
Only whenever they are in your amplitude, doesn't matter, and all the rest are plus. Yes.
And why such a name? So
because it's the first non-vanishing amplitude, and was called amplitude that where the electricity is maximally violated. But as I said, the names are names, and it's more important the content. But so because the first amplitude we have seen were zero, and the first that was non-vanishing was the one with two gluons. So all plus vanish, one minus all plus vanishes, two minus all plus is the first where the electricity is violated maximally in the sense of first non-vanishing. Okay, so from four to n gluon, three, the same decomposition that we have found or we have motivated step by step holds, namely an amplitude can be where we have momentum of gluon, electricity of gluon H, and we have colors for gluon, can be decomposed by factoring out the trace on the color structure A sigma 1 times A sigma n, and here we have the the partial, the color order amplitude, sigma of particle 1, ADCT 1, sigma of particle n, ADCT n, and the sum has to be on all the non-cyclic permutation. So if S of n is the set of all permutation of n object, we have to remove the cyclic one. Okay. So this is just a mathematically compact expression to represent the factorization of the color from the kinematics, which we have seen at 4 gluon and which extend to n gluon. What is important is that once the color is factorized, what we are after, what the actual computation effort we need to put, is to derive, to compute the color order amplitudes. So it's important to understand how many of them are independent or not, so that we compute only one and get the others either by parity and charge conjugation or by using all relation that we could find available, for instance, from group theory. And I have asked you before to remember the fact that in the calculation of the color group of the four gluon, we have been witnessing a decoupling of this term that was going like 1 over nc, because this is an important consequence. Namely, the same decomposition for this amplitude holds both in SUN and in UN. Okay. So if we were working within UN gluon scattering, namely we didn't impose the traceless condition, the same decomposition would have held. And in fact, we have seen that that factors 1 over n decoupled from the calculation. And these factors 1 over n, you remember, was the beta unknown constant that we fixed, and it was due to the traceless condition. So un can be thought as sun cross u1. Okay, and u1 is responsible for the presence or not the presence of the traceless condition. Actually, in SUN, we have derived this color decomposition. 1n, and then we add two vertical lines. For UN, this would have meant just the first product of delta functions without the traceless term. And in this context, U1, of course, here there are fermion, okay, line. And for U1, we could represent it as the square root of this object, namely 1 over n, and then simply one fermion arrow, okay? So the fact that we could have the same color decomposition both in SUN or in UN, it has a dramatic consequence. Why? Because UN, as you see, contains the generator of U1. Okay, so let's associate it to a photon. Although it's not the photon of the QED because of the coupling, but let's assume that it behaves like a photon. The presence of this photon is, as we have seen, it doesn't affect pure gluon calculation, because photon doesn't couple to gluon. So the abelian generator of U1 does not couple in the Young-Mills theory to the non-abelian generators of gluon. So every amplitude in UN, okay, that contains one generator associated to a photon must vanish. So the vanishing of the amplitude in the UN impose some condition on the kinematic amplitude, on the color ordered amplitude. Okay, so the vanishing of the group impose a condition on the kinematic part of the amplitude, but the kinematic part of the amplitude here is the same as SUN. Therefore, from the what is the decoupling of the photon in UN, we can get a condition which relates partial amplitude in SUN, so in QCD, color ordered partial amplitude. And this I will close just with 1 minute beyond the schedule, just with this last slide. This is the four gluon. This is the four gluon decomposed as we have seen before. Now this is A4, and it's called A4. Okay. Now, if you work a little bit of color algebra here with the trace condition with the cyclic properties of trace, you can collect, you can rewrite this amplitude in this way. Now, this term, let's assume that the fourth generator, TA, is the photon, namely, it's proportional to the identity. What does it mean? That the amplitude on the left-hand side must vanish because the photon does not decoupling. On the right-hand side, let's see what are the leftover color structure, let's say, of UN. We see that the whole expression ends up with two color structure multiplied by a linear combination of color order partial amplitude. Okay, this color structure is another color structure of UN. It's called DABC, like FABC. It's the anti-commutator rather than the commutator. Okay, and in general, it doesn't vanish. So in order for this amplitude to vanish, it must vanish the linear combination of this color order partial amplitude. And therefore, okay, we get a relation among amplitudes, so color order amplitudes, namely kinematic amplitudes, where the position of one of these gluon is goes around the amplitude itself. It's a kind of word identities, which is called photon decoupling identities, and which holds to all n, namely. This will be a relation which relates one color order amplitude in terms of all n minus one other amplitude, which we all will hear about in the next coming lecture probably by John Joseph Carrasco. Thank you. Yeah.
Would this be four color amplitude or three color?
No, we started from a four color amplitude in UN.
Yeah.
Okay. One of the generator becomes proportional to the identity, okay? So at the end, we are still, let's say, with four, but one with four generator, one is the identity. Therefore, we have an unvanishing color structure that involves three colors, but the kinematical object are for four gluon ordered scattering amplitudes. So although it looks like we have lost a generator indeed in order to prove this identity, but originally it was there and the kinematics has not been touched by our trick on the color. So we have made some trick on the color side of the amplitude without touching the kinematic, and in fact the kinematic remains intact and gives us this additional relation which reduce the number of independent objects we have to finally compute. Yes, Sophia.
From a physics point of view, what does the maximal helicity violation mean?
The maximal helicity violation, it's just one helicity, okay, set of a, so say if I have five gluon scattering, the maximal helicity violating amplitude correspond to certain possibility of assigning helicity. They don't exhaust all helicities. But rather than physics point of view, I would say from the mathematical point of view, they are very special because of the presence of one kind of spinor product, just the angle and the bracket. And since the mathematical development that there have been for developing new methods actually are based on T theory of complex function, and being the spinor product themselves complex variables, okay, one would relate the presence of one kind of spinor product and not the other to holomorphic rather than non-holomorphic function. This we will probably see. So from the physics point of view, they are nice objects but are just a subset of color order amplitudes. But they have become the building blocks to construct amplitude for different helicity assignment with more pluses or more minus in the formalis, which is due to CSW or MHV construction of 2004 developed by Witten and Cacciaso, because of their properties when you look at them under theory of complex variable, in particular Cauchy's residue theorem.